Welcome to another e-service for Emmanuel Evangelical Lutheran Church of Paynes Point. That's in rural Oregon, Illinois. These videos are designed to serve as a stand-in for our regular Sunday morning worship for those unable to attend in person for any reason. Therefore, this is designed to be participatory. Feel free to pray, confess, and sing along with us. An announcement or two may be included, but please mind your emails and the newsletter to know what's going on in the congregation. Hey, good morning. Thanks for joining us again in this way for our e-service. As you know, this is our primary way of connecting on Sunday morning at the moment as we are refraining from in-person worship again for the time being. Hopefully it's a short time. We are in an attempt to be as responsible as possible, to be as socially and morally responsible, and to contribute to our community by example and by action in the most positive way in light of the circumstances around us. We are doing our best to abide by the guidelines set forth by our Ogle County and State Health Departments. With that in mind, I just want to call your attention to the newsletter. It should have been in your email, the same email that contained a link to this video. And in there, you should find the protocols that Council and I decided on at our last meeting. And things could change, of course. That's, unfortunately, that's kind of the theme of 2020. Things change pretty regularly. But the point is we have a tentative plan that adjusts based on what the guidelines are for our region, again, so we can be as responsible as possible. And what that means is, as long as that protocol stays in place, the tentative plan remains the plan, you can look at what the guidelines are for that week, you know, where we're at now, when it's expected to change, that sort of thing, and determine based on that whether we're having in-person worship, and if we are, if you'll be asked to register if you wish to attend, or possibly, you know, if everything goes well, if everyone behaves and what have you, we get back to in-person worship, and you don't need to worry about registering, which would be awesome. So please do your part as we do our part to get things back to as close to normal as quick as possible. Second announcement, it's All Saints Sunday, All Saints Sunday, and that means we'll have the names, you know, of the recently deceased, as well as names that are submitted for, well, any names that are submitted. And a couple things on this, because it's a more serious, somber sort of service. I won't do any of the cheeky little post-credits thing, for one. And for two, yes, the service will be abbreviated in other ways to make up for that. So it's a little bit different. This isn't going to match what you've seen the past few weeks, months. Let me know what you think. But again, it's just for today. So hopefully we're not doing this next year. We won't be. I declare it. All right, let's get started. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your people together in one communion, in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading comes from Revelation, the 7th chapter. After this, I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these, robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one who knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Here ends the reading.
Servants of God, your master proclaim and publish abroad his wonderful name, the name all victorious of Jesus extol. His kingdom is glorious and rules over all. God ruleth on high, almighty to save, and still he is nigh, his presence we have. The great congregation his triumph shall sing, ascribing salvation to Jesus our King. Salvation to God, who sits on the throne. Let all cry aloud and honor the Son. The praises of Jesus the angels proclaim. Pour down on their faces and worship the Lamb. Let us adore and give him his right. All glory and power, all wisdom and might, and honor and blessing with angels above, and thanks never ceasing with infinite love.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 11th chapter. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Judeans who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Judeans said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." And Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he said this, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." This is the gospel of our Lord. Grace and peace to you, sisters and brothers in Christ. Let me read to you from an open letter to those who are grieving the loss of a loved one, titled, "The Things We Do Not Say." To my dear friend, I know that you have been hurting. And even as days, weeks, and years pass by, it feels like only yesterday that you lost the one you loved. Time has a way of healing wounds. it changes what is normal. The abruptness of loss fades away as living without your beloved slowly becomes routine. Things keep getting better, but they're never quite okay. We've all experienced loss in some way, to some degree, so we know this to be true, and yet it joins a long list of things we simply do not say. When you lose someone you love, things slowly get better, but they will never again be okay. Every sunrise, every sunset, every family dinner, every birthday, and every Christmas, there's an empty chair. People will laugh and love, eat and celebrate, and all the rest. As we swallow the lumps in our throats and brush aside the sting in our hearts. One year it will be subtle enough to carry on like everything is like before. Another it will be too much to bear. We'll leave the room or change the subject or let awkward silence overtake the room. Because admitting what we're all thinking might make it worse, we'll let that sting in our heart join the list of things we simply won't talk about. The things we simply won't say. Strange, isn't it? We bury what should be said and say these other things instead. I told you they're in a better place, but how could that be? What better place is there than with you? I heard another say that God needed an angel. Since when does God need anything? Even if God did, why now? Why couldn't it wait a little longer? More than a few times, someone brought up a plan, God's plan. It's meant to be. Everything happens for a reason. Do you suppose they were trying to convince you? Perhaps they were trying to convince themselves. The day of the funeral, you knew better than anyone that there was no reason, at least no good reason, at least no good enough reason. Not if it was part of some plan, not if it was part of some test. God doesn't use life and death like that. God used the life and death of Jesus to save us, and even Jesus wept at the news that his friend had died. If God's own son with the power to raise his friend from the dead can cry for the sake of his beloved, then so can we. We didn't say that at the funeral. We gave each other passing comfort with assurances that our pain is worth it because God or your beloved or someone else is better for it. The things we should have said instead are on the growing list of things we simply don't say. We'll say, I'm sorry for your loss, and that's a good start, but that's not enough. We don't say, I really mean it. I'm heartbroken. I can't sleep at night. I'm struggling to do the things I must do that I always do, the day-to-day things that seem like such a chore now. We're struggling, denying, negotiating, and every other step in the grieving process, sometimes one after another, sometimes all at once. Some of us are coping in healthy ways, and some of us are coping in other ways. All of this and more, the things we should have said, but simply don't say. As if that weren't hard enough, I know it is much worse for you. You were so much closer to your beloved than any of us, and your pain is that much greater. I can't even imagine it. How do we have the nerve to dismiss your pain so to minimize our own? At least we can claim we don't know any better, but that preacher cannot make any such excuses. I know not every preacher can know the person they're speaking about, but they can always make an attempt. Did he even know how your beloved passed away? How sudden it was, how young they were, and how much you had to scramble to even get there that morning. The stories about his life had nothing to do with what was going on in ours. We weren't there to dwell in his memories. I still don't know if that was worse, or the fact that what followed was not much more than 10 more minutes of the same sort of stuff that we told you at the wake. It's God's plan and all that. The last breath they took on earth was their first breath in heaven. They zipped off as a bodiless soul, angels in tow, straight to paradise. They get to do all the fun things they like to do in this life all the time now. I've been in church enough times to know that's not how any of this works. Sunday morning after Sunday morning, they read from the Bible. In there, Jesus keeps talking about the last day. There's a resurrection that's coming. In another place, it says this happens in a single moment, like the twinkling of an eye. Over and over, we're told that when we die, it's as if we've gone to sleep. Then we all rise at the same time, the moment Jesus returns. The list of things we should have said but simply do not say is long, but that preacher's list is longer. Your beloved is at peace. They are at rest. Is that not comfort enough? You will see your beloved again. You will rise along with them on the last day. Is that not comfort enough? I would ask you why the preacher didn't just say those things, but I am sure I already know the answer. He's as human as you or me or any of the rest of us. He wanted to take away your pain now. He didn't want the awkward silence, the lump in your throat, the sting in your heart. That will still come in time, but he wanted to brush them away, if only for that day. The list of things we simply don't say is so long, in part because we don't want to admit that we are sad, because we don't want to admit that we are scared, and we don't want to admit that we are weak. It is too much to admit to ourselves, much less to the whole world, that something as common as death, something everyone faces sooner or later, can beat us so mercilessly and bring us to our knees. Enough people have pretended that they are stronger than that for long enough that now we think there's something wrong with us when we're the ones breaking down. Feels like it's just me. We don't want to admit we are weak as that, even though each and every one of us is exactly that weak. That preacher with his quivering voice and shaking knees put that same insecurity on God. For him, and therefore for us, God could not be shaken. God could not, for one fraction of a second, be out of control. Every dead battery and every smoke detector, every brake pedal that doesn't get used, every virus that mutates, every human cell that splits every single time, trillions upon trillions upon trillions of instances just to decide which one will be cancer and which one will not. All of that just to say that God was so in control that even this horrific tragedy is part of God's plan. We're playing out the script. We're just reading our lines. God planned this pain all along just so you could feel it. Anything less would be unacceptable to that preacher. God had to be bigger than all of it, or else God wouldn't be big enough. God had to be cold, deliberate, and dedicated to the plan. If it's enough to ease our pain, that this was all part of the plan, then surely God is moving along, splitting those cells and draining those batteries, just another day for God. Anything less would mean God is weak, like we are weak. But again, I've been to church enough Sundays to know that's not how it works either. When God walked the earth in Jesus, he knew pain and loss of all kinds. He did it better than any of us ever could, and yet again, when faced with the death of his friend Lazarus, he was so disturbed. His very core was shaken. He was moved to tears. The list of things that preacher should have said but simply doesn't say includes this: God weeps too. God weeps with us. God is disturbed by this news too. The moment your beloved's heart stopped beating, God's heart broke with yours. Is that not comfort enough? I'm writing you today because I have seen in myself and in too many of your friends and family that while we say plenty, it's not okay that we've failed to say these things. Let me take a few things off of my own list, the list of things I simply don't say, as I share them with you now. I see your beloved when I'm on the street. Faces pass by, and for brief moments, I think they are there. I come across stories online, items for sale in the store. My first thought is to share them with your beloved. It then sets in once again that I cannot. Songs that used to seem distant, unrelatable experiences about death and grief, now feel like they were written for you, for your beloved, and for us. As time passes, days grow shorter, things get back to normal. That pressure to be strong and pretend like everything is okay will only grow. Do not let it. You do not need to move on. You do not need to pretend that you're okay. You do not need to go looking for how this fits into some plan, God's plan or anyone else's. You also don't have to face any of this alone. You may feel alone. Of course you feel alone. How could you not? Yet we are all still here for you. That includes me, but all the rest of us too, who still have things we should say. Your friends, your family, your church, your God, we're all here for you. Being sad, even breaking down, does not mean you are weak, at least not any weaker than anyone else. Even Jesus wept. Do not forget that. It's not on my list of things I have not said, but I can assure you it's on others. I love you. We all love you. We loved your beloved, too. Perhaps we've said it, but I doubt we've said it enough. I doubt we could say it enough. I know we could not say it too much. Lastly, my dear friend, your beloved was God's beloved too. I want you to know that and to know that my questioning what that preacher said and did not say is not because of some crisis of faith, quite the opposite. The lump in your throat, the sting in your heart, those are signs of such tremendous sorrow. That kind of sorrow can only come from a loss that's just as tremendous, losing someone for whom you had such tremendous love. As far as God has a plan, that pretty much sums it up for me. God put us here to know and to love, and so that we could know and love God and each other. That's a tremendous gift and a tremendous joy. The sorrow that comes with your tears, with my tears, and with Jesus' tears. Well, maybe we can call it the cost, or the consequence, or just the unfortunate reality of how things work. The greater the love, the greater the loss. The better our time together, the more it will hurt when it's over. If it were any other way, we wouldn't really know and love each other. At least not like we have, not like we're supposed to. I am convinced that's what this world and this age are for. It's so we can really learn what it is to know and love each other. God's plan included this. It includes the next age, the resurrection, and relationships that last forever. It's just these details along the way that aren't filled in ahead of time. God's watching them unfold along the way, right along with us. Most of them don't mean much. Another leaf falls from the tree and hits the ground. Some of them hurt like hell. Another life draws to a close. The list of things we don't say is so tragically long. Mine is now a little shorter. Thank you for that. This was just as much for me as it was for you, but if I have any advice to leave you with, it's just this. Take care of yourself. Be strong when you can, but let yourself be weak too. And start saying those things that we simply don't say. Amen.
I'll just be here if you want me. It's no use in keeping a stiff upper lip. You can weep, you can sleep, you can loosen your grip. You can frown, you can drown and go down with the ship. You can cry if you want to. Don't ever apologize, venting your pain. It's something to me you don't need to explain. I don't need to know why, I don't think it's insane. You can cry if you want to. The windows are closed, the neighbors aren't home. If it's better with me than to do it alone, I'll draw the curtains and unplug the phone. You can cry if you want to. Thank you. You can stare at the ceiling and tear at your hair, swallow your feelings and stagger and swear. You can show things and throw things and I wouldn't care. You can cry if you want to. I won't make fun of you. I won't tell anyone. I won't analyze what you do or you should have done. I won't advise you to go and have fun. You can cry if you want to. Well, it's empty and ugly and terribly sad. I can't feel what you feel, but I know it feels bad. I know that it's real and it makes you so mad. You could cry. Cry if you want to. I won't tell you not to. I won't try to cheer you up. I'll just be here if you want me to be near you.
Longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all in need. Lord, of all the saints, we praise you for evangelists and martyrs whose sacrifices witness to your gospel across time and space. Inspire us by their courage to carry our faith to new people and places around us. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, of every place, the universe proclaims your greatness from generation to generation. Bless the work of naturalists, conservationists, and park rangers who train our attention to the wonders of the world you have made. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, of every nation, guide this country, red states and blue states, rural voters and urban voters, young and old, as we share in another national election. Kindle hearts eager to understand our common needs and seek our common good. We pray as well for those who may be in harm's way, striving for the common good. We pray for John, Josh, Tyler, Morgan, Jack, Robert, Matt, Nick, and Dane. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, of every blessing, your Son's blessing came to those living with poverty, grief, hunger, thirst, and persecution. Shape our vision of the saints to match his own. Awaken us to your call to serve all who suffer. We pray for Jerry, Joe, Jim, Robin, Gail, Lisa, Joni, Chloe, Connie, Larry, Cindy, John, and Melody, Grace, Danny, Doug, Bailey, Connie, and Kendall, Jean, Horst, Barbara, Richard, Serenata, Ann, Larry, Carol, Jean, Mary, Jean, Edie, Leona, Amy, Dean, Andrea, Dennis, Ida, and Mabel, Charlene, and Bethel, and Lynette, and Elizabeth. We pray for all those afflicted by the pandemic in any way. Give healing and wholeness to those who need it, strength and resolve to those healthcare workers and essential workers worn thin. Give wisdom to our leadership. And give each of us the endurance that we need. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of every venture, anoint us with the missionary spirit of the early church. Bless all new missions of our synod and churchwide. Empower testimony from new communities of faith to shape a diverse witness to your saving power. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of every time, countless are the multitudes you have called by name and gathered to yourself. Comfort us as we grieve those who have died in the past year and those for whom we still mourn, even as years have passed. We give you thanks in remembrance of Marjorie M. Erickson. Linda Sue Burdick. John Ranke. Goldie Ranke. Dave Ranke. Thank you. Reuben Epler. Nina Clemens. Agnes Elliott. Lois Groenhagen Nelson. Karen Sheldon. Robert Sheldon. Betty Sheldon. Tammy O'Hare. Mary Beth Young. Stephanie Potter Kays. Gilbert DeWitt. Iva Bartel. Nancy Schumacher. Ben Kayo. Eileen Kayo. Teresa Kayo. In faith, may we join with them in ceaseless praise. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of all the living, we give thanks for the gift of new life, that even in the ordeals of this world, we see hope in the faces of newborns and the newly baptized. We give thanks, therefore, and pray for those born into our lives this past year and those baptized into Christ. We remember and give thanks for Oakley Herman, baptized into you in this congregation this past year. Lord, in your mercy. Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord, remember us when you come into your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. As you take a moment to share a sign of peace by text or by chat, let me remind you that when we cannot gather in person, like right now, our offerings are almost entirely gathered by mail, mostly mailed directly to the financial secretary. So, as we pray over these gifts given, we give thanks for your generosity and give thanks to God for God's abundance. Let us pray. God of goodness, generations have turned to you, gathered around your table, and shared your abundant blessings. Number us among them. As we gather these gifts from your abundance and give thanks for your rich blessing, may we feast upon your very self and care for all that you have made through Jesus Christ, our sovereign and servant. Amen. As you go forth responsibly into your own home, may the God of all creation, in whose image you are made, who claims us and calls us beloved, who strengthens us for service, give you reason to rejoice and be glad. The blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you today and always. Amen. Beloved of God, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
For all the saints who from their labors rest, who thee by faith before the world confessed, thy name, O Jesus, be forever blessed. Their rock, their fortress, and their might. Thou, Lord, their captain in the well-fought fight. Thou, in the darkness, spread their one true light. Alleluia. Thy soldiers, faithful, true, and bold, fight as the saints who nobly fought of old, and win with them the victor's crown of gold. Alleluia. Communion, fellowship divine, we feebly struggle, they in glory shine. Yet all are one in thee, for all are thine. Alleluia. Alleluia. And when the strife is fierce, the warfare long, steals on the ear the distant triumph song, and hearts are brave again, and arms are strong. Alleluia. Alleluia. The golden evening brightens in the west, soon, soon to faithful warriors cometh rest. Sweet is the calm of paradise, the blessed. Alleluia. Alleluia. But lo, there breaks a yet more glorious day. The saints triumphant rise in bright array. The King of glory passes on his way. Alleluia. Earth's wide bounds, from ocean's farthest coast, through gates of pearl, streams in the countless host, singing to Father. Son, and Holy Ghost. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thank you once again for joining us in this way. These videos started as a response to the shutdowns associated with the COVID-19 pandemic, which has been an anxious and uncertain time. You tuning in this way helps the whole congregation and extended community stay connected even at a distance. Your time and thoughtfulness is very much appreciated. Be responsible, stay safe, and have a great week. Thanks again.